Anne Marie Lewis and Spoken Realms present Kings, Queens, and Pawns, An American Woman at the Front. Written by Mary Roberts Rinehart. Narrated by Anne Marie Lewis. Kings, Queens, and Pawns. For King and Country. March in England is spring. Early in the month, masses of snowdrops lined the paths in Hyde Park. The grass was green, the roads hard and dry under the eager feet of Kitchener's great army. For months, they had been drilling, struggling with the intricacies of a new career, working and waiting. And now it was spring, and soon they would be off. Some had already gone. "Lucky beggars," said the ones who remained, and counted the days. And, waiting, they drilled. Everywhere there were squads. Scots in plaid kilts with khaki tunics, less picturesque but equally imposing regiments in the field uniform, with officers hardly distinguishable from their men. Everywhere the same grim but cheerful determination to get over and help the boys across the channel to assist in holding that more than 400 miles of battle line against the invading hosts of Germany. Here in Hyde Park that spring day was all the panoply of war. Bands playing, the steady tramp of numberless feet, the muffled clatter of accoutrement, the homage of the waiting crowd. And they deserved homage, those fine, upstanding men, many of them hardly more than boys, marching along with a fine, full swing. There is something magnificent, a contagion of enthusiasm, in the sight of a great volunteer army. The North and the South knew the thrill during our own great war. Conscription may form a great and admirable machine, but it differs from the trained army of volunteers as a body differs from a soul. But it costs a country heavy in griefs, does a volunteer army, for the flower of the country goes. That, too, America knows, and England is learning. They marched by gaily, the drums beat, the passers-by stopped. Here and there, an open carriage or an automobile drew up, and pale men, some of them still in bandages, sat and watched. In their eyes was the same flaming eagerness, the same impatience to get back, to be loosed against the old lion's foes. For king and country. All through England, all through France, all through that tragic corner of Belgium, which remains to her, are similar armies, drilling and waiting, equally young, equally eager, equally resolute. And the thing they were going to, I knew. I had seen it in that mysterious region which had swallowed up those who had gone before, in the trenches, in the operating rooms of field hospitals, at outposts between the confronting armies where the sentries walked hand in hand with death. I had seen it in its dirt and horror and sordidness, this thing they were going to. War is not two great armies meeting in a clash and frenzy of battle. It is much more than that. War is a boy carried on a stretcher, looking up at God's blue sky with bewildered eyes that are soon to close. War is a woman carrying a child that has been wounded by a shell. War is spirited horses tied in burning buildings and waiting for death. War is the flower of a race, torn, battered, hungry, bleeding, up to its knees in icy water. War is an old woman burning a candle before the Mater Dolorosa for the son she has given. For king and country. Chapter 1. Taking a Chance. I started for the continent on a bright day early in January. I was searched by a woman from Scotland Yard before being allowed on the platform. The pockets of my fur coat were examined. My one piece of baggage, a suitcase, was inspected. My letters of introduction were opened and read. "Now, Mrs. Rinehart," she said, straightening, "just why are you going?" I told her exactly half of why I was going. I had a shrewd idea that the question in itself meant nothing, but it gave her a good chance to look at me. She was a very clever woman. "And so, having been discovered to be carrying neither weapons nor seditious documents, and having an open and honest eye, I was allowed to go through the straight and narrow way that led to possible destruction. Once or twice, later on, I blamed that woman for letting me through. I blamed myself for telling only half my reasons for going. Had I told her all, she would have detained me safely in England, where automobiles sometimes go less than 80 miles an hour, and where a sharp bang means a door slamming in the wind and not a shell exploding. Where hostile aeroplanes overhead with bombs and unpleasant little steel darts were not always between one's eyes and heaven. She let me through, and I went out on the platform. The leaving of the 1 o'clock train from Victoria Station, London, is an event and a tragedy. Wounded who have recovered are going back. Soldiers who have been having their week at home are returning to that mysterious region across the channel, the front. Not the least of the British achievements had been to transport, during the deadlock of the first winter of the war, almost the entire army, in relays, back to England for a week's rest. It had been done without the loss of a man, across a channel swarming with hostile submarines. They came in thousands, covered with mud, weary, eager, their eyes searching the waiting crowd for some beloved face. And those who waited and watched as the cars emptied sometimes wept with joy and sometimes turned and went away alone. Their week over, rested, tidy, eyes still eager but now turned toward France, the station platform beside the 1 o'clock train was filled with soldiers going back. There were few to see them off. There were not many tears. Nothing is more typical of the courage and patriotism of the British women than that platform beside the 1 o'clock train at Victoria. The crowd was shut out by ropes, and Scotland Yard men stood guard. And out on the platform, saying little because words are so feeble, pacing back and forth slowly, went these silent couples. They did not even touch hands. One felt that all the unselfish stoicism and restraint would crumble under the familiar touch. The platform filled. Sir Pertab Singh, an Indian prince, with his suite, was going back to the English lines. I had been a neighbor of his at Claridge's Hotel in London. I caught his eye. It was filled with cold suspicion. It said quite plainly that I could put nothing over on him. But whether he suspected me of being a newspaper writer or a spy, I do not know. Somehow, considering that the train was carrying a suspicious and turbaned Indian prince, any number of impatient officers and soldiers, and an American woman who was carefully avoiding the War Office and trying to look like a buyer crossing the channel for hats, the whistle for starting sounded rather inadequate. It was not martial. It was thin, effeminate, absurd. And so we were off, moving slowly past that line on the platform where no one smiled, where grief and tragedy, in that one revealing moment, were written deep.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.